Good morning and welcome to worship. This is Sunday, July 18th, 2021. This is the eighth Sunday in Pentecost. We're in a little different setting this morning, but we're still here at our Savior. So anyway, good morning, and I hope you've all had a good week. Let us begin our service. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawing to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. for the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen.
When I got in the morning, when I rise in the morning, when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. Jesus, you can have all this world, just give me Jesus. When I am alone, when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. All this world, just give me Jesus.
Powerful and compassionate, you shepherd your people, faithfully feeding and protecting us. Heal each of us and make us whole people, that we may embody the justice and peace of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The first reading is from Jeremiah. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, says the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who shepherd my people. It is you who have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. So I will attend to you for your evil doings, says the Lord. Then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the lands where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them, and they shall not fear any longer or be dismayed, nor shall any be missing, says the Lord. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. And this is the name by which he will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. The word of the Lord. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. You restore my soul, O Lord, and guide me along right pathways for your namesake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup is running over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The second reading is from Ephesians. Remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcision by those who are called the circumcision, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you at that time were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints, and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you are also built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the 6th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. He said to them, "Come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a deserted place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they hurried there on foot from all the towns and arrived ahead of them. And as he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. When they had crossed over, they came to the land of Gennesaret and moored the boat. When they got out of the boat, people at once recognized him and rushed about that whole region and began to bring the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into villages or cities or farms, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged him that they might touch even the fringe of his cloak. And all who touched it were healed. Praise to you, O Christ. So, how many of you need a vacation right now? Even if you've already had a vacation this summer, maybe you're ready for another one. I mean, really, a nice getaway from it all. Leave your work behind, take off, and try to forget all about your problems. After a year of not being able to travel or get away from it all, we are all exhausted. We have all been busy with a life that has been different, and we are tired. Your job, your family, your retirement time with friends or here at church has been a time of rebooting. It's just time to take off and be. Where will we go? What will we do? Will it be with family and maybe go to a water park? Will it be a long drive out west and everybody is anxious to get there and you need a vacation from your vacation when you get back? They are tired of miles and miles of nothing. Sort of like this past year has been. Will it be time to yourself in a quiet place along the river with a good book? Will it be time away to be spiritual, just being in nature and listening for God? Vacation or getting away means so many things to different people. Today, Jesus is inviting his disciples to come away with him and rest. What does that mean to them then and to us now, to rest? A good shepherd knows how to care for his flock. So as we have followed Jesus through Mark's gospel, many things have occurred. Jesus is rejected in his hometown. He sends out to 12 to share the good news. John the Baptist is killed and beheaded. And today, the part that's left out of the reading, Jesus feeds 5,000 and walks on water. The theme of all of this is the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is like what to you? So the disciples have been busy. They have shared with Jesus all the places they have been and all that they had taught. And Jesus sees that they need rest. But will rest elude them as it often does us today? The shepherd is attempting to guide his flock to a peaceful, quiet place, free of predators. So they gather on a boat and head out to the other side, the deserted side. And lo and behold, someone sees them loading up and heads into town yelling, "They are leaving. We want to hear more. More people need to be healed. We can't let them get away." So they take off on foot and beat Jesus and the disciples to the other side. You can imagine when the boat floats ashore, "Surprise! Here we are. We thought you were getting away. Please tell us more. Please heal some more. Please, just one more time, Jesus." We know that feeling of anxiousness and tiredness. One more thing. I just can't. And so it was for the disciples. But unlike our probable response to the people, Jesus feels sorry for these people, and he says they look like sheep without a shepherd. They didn't know where to go, what to do. They were helpless. They had no leader, no king. Herod was off carousing, chasing women, and beheading people. That's not much for leadership. They are looking for the next king. Is this him, they wonder? Jesus sees and understands them and begins to teach them. He feels sorry for them. A good shepherd knows when his or her flock needs rest, knows when they are tired. There might not be anyone you know telling you to rest, but the loving shepherd Jesus tells us today to rest. So when was the last time you had a well-deserved quiet time to let go of all the things that weigh you down? A time to find a deserted place and to just be. That you heard Jesus say to you, "Come away with me for a little while and rest. Come away with me and see what needs you need to let go of." Jesus was known to have gone in the desert to be alone and pray. And he was there when the devil tempted him. He went off to the garden to be alone the night before his crucifixion. He knew where to go to find rest and to find God. How do we get ourselves to this place? Our desert time, a time to ponder, to pay attention, to pray. We work so hard with jobs and families, social justice causes, that we fall into a place of despair. We have leaders who want more and more out of us, leaders who have not led as Jesus would want them to lead. And we feel as if we have been left alone and are not sure what to do next. How can we help anyone if we can't help ourselves? I read a little clip this week using a small boy as an example of just starting to cry because he was just so tired. Ball games, school, friends. He didn't know what to expect. To fall into his mother or father's arms and cry was all that he could do. We are all that boy at times. We need to let Jesus shepherd us into a quiet place on the other side. We need to fall into the arms of the Father and just cry our hearts out. Many of the mystics would go to the desert to be alone and find themselves, to hear God speak to themselves. It's in those desert places we can find a sense of ourselves again. There's no noise, no phones, nothing but us, nature, and God. There is the gentle breeze blowing through our hair, and there's nobody talking to us and at us except maybe a desert animal. In the desert, there is no peace if our heart has no peace. What happens when we have no shepherd to lead us in our lives? The story is strange but true. When he was four years old, Shrek, the Murano sheep from New Zealand, decided he no longer wanted to be sheared every year and thought the best option would be to hide in a cave for 6 years. Eventually, he was found by the shepherds and he was shorn, shedding almost 60 pounds of wool. Merino sheep were bred to produce wool continuously, so without regular shearing, Sheck's wool grew and grew, and he had to lug around that extra weight while hiding. He was indeed a sheep without a shepherd. Do we tend to be like Shrek and hide away from the shepherd, thinking we know what is best for us, but harming ourselves instead? What are the 60 pounds of wool that we need to be relieved of? In seminary, we had spiritual practice class, and we practiced different spiritual practices in order to find out which one might work for us. We would sit in silence for 30 minutes, and the first time we did this, we'd ask afterwards how long it took our minds to settle in and not to wander. Most of us had just reached that point when the time ended. We practiced repeating Bible verse over and over in our minds as we listened to quiet music. We spent time at the monastery in quietness for a day. This wasn't a magical fix, but finding something that works for you. All of these aren't one-time practices. They take discipline and they take practice. We were asked where our desert place was. Mine is on my farm. Be it a summer day, watching the rhythm of life and the planting of a seed in the spring to its harvest in the fall, the quiet breeze, the first snowfall of winter. This is my desert place. Your desert place doesn't have to be fancy. You don't have to wander off. It can be a walk along the river, a hike in the state park, a day of fishing on the water, wherever it is that you can find God. Barbara Brown Taylor, a well-known Episcopal priest and author, talks about being a pastor in a large urban setting and running to meetings, visits, etc., busy all the time. She felt like she was losing her faith. She couldn't hear God talking to her anymore. So she and her husband take off to find a place to live in the country. They live near Atlanta, so we are talking about a rural area in Georgia. They find a quaint little farm away from everything. She stepped away from ministry for a while, and she took time to hear God again in the small things. She talked about hanging clothes on a line as a spiritual practice. This is something I still do all summer and fall, and I'd never thought of it in that way. Now I do, and she is right. We spend so much time running around that we lose our way. We don't need everything we think we need. We don't need every position we need to have in order to be successful. We don't need every minute of every day filled with things to do. Instead, Jesus reminds us, come with me and rest. Remember the Sabbath day, a day to rest. This next week, I invite you to take and read and recite Psalm 23. Listen to the words carefully as you speak each one of them. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. Use this as your spiritual practice. And think about what is God saying to you about rest. So I invite you to take your bulletin or a piece of paper and write down one thing you will not do this week. One night where you will shut off the TV or your cell phone. Don't take on another obligation. Instead, take time to walk outdoors, play a game with a friend or a child, sit alone with the psalm, and read and take in every word that God is speaking to you. Then write down two things that you discovered during that time this week. This is the beginning of losing all that extra wool that you have been carrying around this year. Like I said, it takes time. So take Jesus' invitation to you. Go and rest a while with your Lord and Savior. Rejuvenate yourself for the work of the kingdom. Amen. Now may the peace of God that passes all understanding keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Became sin, who knew no sin, we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and he carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. Body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out, all for love. Whole earth trembled, the veil was torn. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, a ransom from heaven. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all our hope is in you. All the glory to you, God, light of the world, Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, rescue for sinners, ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. Lord of all.
Let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Rooted in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all of creation. Tend your church, O God. Encourage bishops, pastors, and deacons in their proclamation of the gospel. Raise up new leaders and encourage those pursuing a call to ministry. Embolden all the baptized to embody your love and justice. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Restore your creation, O God. Sustain croplands and pastures and safeguard all farm animals and livestock. Preserve lakes and rivers and streams that offer refreshment. Revive lands recovering from natural disasters and protect coastlands threatened by rising oceans. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Reconcile the nations, O God. Break down the dividing walls that make us strangers to one another, and unite us as one human family. Equip leaders to deal wisely with conflict and guide diplomats who seek peaceful solutions. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Heal your people, O God. Look with compassion on immigrants, exiles, and all who are afraid or feel lost. Give rest to those who are weary, comfort to those who are grieving, and recovery to those who are ill, especially those we name in our hearts before you now. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Nourish this congregation, O God. Prepare a table where we receive food for our hungering spirits. Renew our commitment to provide for one another and revitalize our ministries of feeding and nurturing hungry neighbors. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. You lead us home, O God. We give thanks for all who have died, now citizens with the saints. As you have received them into your heavenly home, so welcome all of us to dwell in your house forever. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. We lift these things and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive God's blessing, the blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen. Go in peace. You are the body of Christ. Thanks be to God.
My fears relieved.
our precious dead grace appeared. The hour of first belief. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secure. He will my shield and portion be. Chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing. Chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing. Shall soon dissolve thy soul. Sun forever to shine. The God who called me here below, be forever mine. Forever mine. You are forever.